Hello, listeners. Welcome to the first Storytel English podcast. And today I have with me Shuromita and I'm Yogesh. Today we are going to talk a little bit about the English audiobook catalogue that Storytel has in India. And as a special treat, we have in the second part of podcast, a cricket podcast with Sanjay Manjrekar.
Hi, everyone.
So, Shuromita, since when are you listening to audiobooks?
Well, it has been many years actually now. I used to kind of download the podcasts and on iTunes and also other international sites that I used to listen to podcasts and audiobooks from. And it's been wonderful to see the new catalog on Storytel, and we have got extremely exciting stories here on our platform.
So how many English audiobooks are on Storytel now?
There are almost 10,000 plus audiobooks on Storytel, and the whole roster of books are just amazing. And I think we have got all the best sellers and most popular books all on the platform, and it's very delightful.
I have just started listening to The Short History of Almost Everything by Bill Bryson, and I find it a very, very lovely book to listen to. So can you also tell some of the titles which you liked recently?
Well, I was listening to Sapiens, which was done by Derek Perkins, written by Yuval Harari. And I have also read the book, and that was a different experience. And when you hear the story on audio, it's almost like somebody talking to you, and it just makes so much more sense. And it's much more more comprehending. And at least, I mean, that had been one very good experience. Apart from that, we also have The Brief History of Time by Stephen Hawking. And we have The Order of Time by Benedict Cumberbatch, which has been narrated by him.
And it's going to release tomorrow, isn't it?
It's going to be releasing tomorrow, yeah. So
coming back to Sapiens, I mean, reading it, did you think that US would elect Donald Trump as a president? I mean,
well, absolutely not. But but I guess so. We have to now do with Donald Trump for as long as he's here with us.
Another book that I really enjoyed listening was Sanjay Manjrekar's Imperfect in his own voice, which is in fact out today.
How has it like come out with the beauty of that story, like as he's speaking himself? Does that really make it more interesting, talking about his own life? He's talking about his experience on the cricket field.
Yes, it does. It helps that he's a commentator, so he's very comfortable when he's speaking about or when he's narrating the book. But one thing that comes across is because it's his own story, the emotions kind of, they reach you when he's talking about the highs and lows in his own life. And I think that's a nice thing, which especially in a lot of English books, I think the authors do it themselves. I remember reading Norse Mythology by Neil Gaiman. And again, the book was wonderful. Listen, we again have something new which is coming up. That's the story of a long-distance marriage, isn't it? Which I think is the first audio book which will be released with a paper book with HarperCollins in India.
That's quite an amazing thing that is happening for the first time, I guess, right?
At least with Harper. I think with outside Harper. India, it's something which happens quite
in India,
quite
yeah.
common. So what are the other books that you're looking forward to in audio in coming months? Is there anything specific book that you think would do great for audio?
Well, currently I'm reading Start With Why, by written and narrated by Simon Sinek. And I think it is quite amazing. And it's one of the bestsellers right now that we've seen internationally. And the books coming up are, of course, Order of Time, that I'm really looking forward to. And also Ravinder Singh's I Too Had a Love Story. That definitely I would love to listen to.
I think I would love to listen to that book as well, because I haven't actually read it. Thanks for being along, and love having you here. Yeah, for dear listeners, do check out the English books which we have over there. And after a brief break, you will listen to Sanjay Manjrekar's podcast. Thank you.
Thank you.
The IPL. The IPL.
That's it. Not need I say anymore. You know, there are those that love it, those that hate it.
The little thing before it has changed over the years. There was the DLF IPL, then the
Pepsi IPL,
and now the Vivo IPL. But IPL is still IPL.
IPNL exist in the lives of every cricket fans, whether they're happy about it or not. And even those that might have been skeptical earlier, Sanjay Manjrekar.
You know what Ramchandra Guha, I think, said, or somebody said when the IPL came into its own, he said it's cricket for the non-cricket lovers.
You know, interesting.
So that is the thing about IPL.
I know till date Michael Holding doesn't call it cricket.
Yes, but my daughter Devika doesn't watch any other cricket but IPL. So there you get that kind of an audience.
So then let's try and figure out the IPL. Where does it stand after 10 glorious years or 10 years of certainly nothing short of entertainment or not short of incident? But tell me how you were when it started off in 2008. Which way were you on the fence? Were you skeptical? Oh my God, is this going to ruin cricket or is it going to do something to cricket that I don't see it working or surviving? And what has changed in 10 years?
I think the greatest gift that we have as human beings, and if you're a little educated, is skepticism. I think everyone's got to be skeptic. Why believe anything that anyone says? Be skeptical about everything. And I think the world would have been a better place. So with the IPL as well, when it came into its own, I was skeptical. Because Indian fans have a funny way of following cricket. You know, if cricket was a popular sport in India, there would have been thousands of people watching Ranji Trophy cricket. Intercollegiate final, inter-school final, which happens in America when you look at baseball. All levels of baseball and football in England are followed. Cricket, only when the Indian cricket team plays do people come to watch. So I was very skeptical about an intercity league, despite all the drama around it, whether it would work. And the stakes were very high. It wasn't like an experimental thing that we'll try and where, you know, you're just putting in a few lakhs of rupees and see how it goes. It actually was conceptualized with big stakes. So I must confess, very skeptical about it.
But cricket in general has such a different nucleus about the sport. It's not like football, where club cricket or club football has been the norm and international football the exception. You get friendlies, you get a FIFA World Cup, and that's just about it. Cricket has been a patriotic national sense. So even if you look at county cricket in England, it might have succeeded as a concept, but it didn't necessarily receive adulation from beyond England. You know, even Great Britain or Europe or other parts. IPL now suddenly, there are Mumbai Indians fans based in Dubai that I know of. There are Chennai Super Kings fans based in the US. So suddenly it's adapting to that football culture. It's changing the way cricket is being received. What do you think has caused it? Just because it has the best players playing, the best players played county cricket as well.
I'm not sure whether it's the loyalty which is its biggest feature or its biggest USP. What works with the IPL is, first of all, the timings. Starts at 8 p.m., where people in Mumbai can, you know, finish their work and are starved of, you know, after 8 p.m. entertainment. It was always going to restaurants and watch movies.
I think in general, in India, we're starved of entertainment.
Absolutely. So you had another option. So this was like an sort of night out for people. T20 cricket. And what really helped IPL, people don't give it the due importance, is the Bollywood glamour.
Do you think that made a difference?
Huge difference. Shah Rukh Khan, you know, on the
KKR the balcony or sitting at the table for KKR.
Yes, and you know, the kind of showmanship that went around it. It got the non-cricket fans to come and watch
it. It got
the
them
game.
Asking questions. Are Shah Rukh kya kar raha hai? What is he doing buying a cricket
team? I
mean,
my daughter is a great example of somebody who's not at all into cricket but supported KKR because Shah Rukh Khan was their owner and he was there at the grounds as well. There were other film stars as well.
Except for a little while at One Kid Stadium. But let's
Yes, where he
out.
Was. Yeah. Yeah. Not needed for some reason. So, you know, that helped.
Yes.
Because people had watched cricket for a long time. This was cricket with a difference.
But why has this mantra not worked in other sport? You know, the ISL has tried it and put Abhishek Bachchan there and Ranbir Kapoor there and John Abraham there. And, you know, we have Kabaddi, which has tried to, again, do the concoction of the cocktail of Bollywood and, you know, try and make the sport work. And it's not quite taken off like cricket.
It might take a while. I love the effort that's been put into these sports to make it, you know, a sort of a competitive sport to cricket as well. You know, can't be just one sport nation. But India, as I said, is a very strange country in the way it follows its sports as well. It just follows one sport, has for a number of years, but that is changing. and a change is slowly happening. When you look at England, go to Australia, South Africa, you can see they're sports lovers and they follow three or four sports together. Maybe they like one more than the other, but India is one sport nation, and that is the reason why IPL works. So when people give Lalit Modi the credit for it, he deserves a lot of it. But it was a win-win situation, apart from the intercity league gamble, that this was T20 cricket and very fashionable format at the time. And it was cricket and it was going to have the best stars around the world. The ICL didn't work because it didn't have the cream of international playing at the times. It was a popular sport, but didn't work. So it had a lot of things going for it.
Which is why other leagues have not been able to replicate the success of the IPL. While the Big Bash League has worked, it's because Australia have a sporting culture, which, you know, like you said, India is a unique country in a sense. What I will ask you, I think the conversation of what has the IPL done for Indian cricket is now overdone. Everyone agrees that it's made India much better. Limited oversight, skill set has been enhanced, all that, youngsters hitting the Dale Steyns and, you know, Trent Bolts of the world out around the park. That's, we never thought that would happen. I'll take another tangent. What the IPL has led to is local leagues in every state. We had a Mumbai Premier League recently, which had a chief mentor and a chief ambassador.
I loved its tagline.
Did you?
Yeah, me Mumbai kar, me cricket kar.
Can you spend 3 hours and explain what it was? No? Already? No, even I won't.
I'll spend 5 seconds to analyze it, saying it's the worst tagline ever.
Okay. But we've had the TNPL, the KPL. Every state seems to have it. And I'm trying to think of whether it's going to be good or, you know, if it's just going to be one of those things that just go around which nobody cares about. Will it be a feeder system for the IPL? Or is it going to be an overkill of the league system? Because do you think naturally there would be a structure then? You know, like how first-class cricket will lead to test cricket. So IPL is the equivalent to test cricket and then all these things would be. But where do you see the place for that?
See, already we're seeing players coming from these leagues and, you know, playing in the IPL and then playing for India as well. Washington Sundar is an example. There are quite a few of these kind of rookie, you know, talent that came through these leagues. So that is certainly happening. But you must go to the root sort of cause of these leagues sprouting up. Why are associations getting into this? It's about, you know, wanting to do something that somebody else is doing. Why did Mumbai have this league? Because they were thinking, you know, T20 format is popular. There's the IPL. Tamil Nadu is doing it. Karnataka is doing it. Let us do it as well. And it's fun to
joining
organize
the bandwagon.
Yes, it's a bit like that. And it's also nice to have your own product, right? When you have your own event, there'll be a lot of people watching. Then you become sort of, you know, the focal point of attention. And again, post 7 p.m., there is a bit of attraction to the event as well, if it's not the most popular. So I think that is the main reason. Time will tell whether it is financially viable for these associations. And maybe the television channels also might feel that it's not worthwhile, you know, giving them so much airtime, although live cricket always works. So time will tell. It's not a necessity. But it's there at the moment for the reasons that I just said.
Washington Sundar, you mentioned, one of many under-19 players that's been a revelation. There's a fear when under-19 players come to the IPL because if they get a lot of money, you know, Washington Sundar's got a decent amount of money. There's a Shubman Gill who'll play for Kolkata and there are fast bowlers who were so impressive in the under-19 World Cup. And I know Rahul Dravid and Dilip Vengsarkar have all said, no, we need to watch out for how we get these under-19s, make so much money. Maybe there should be a cap and all those things. Are you worried about the effect of money? Forget international cricketers and overpaid cricketers, but the effect of such money on teenagers.
It is a worry, but I'm one for free market. You know, we are living in a capitalist economy and something that we have to accept is going to be one of the fallouts, that there will be this kind of financial incentives, attractions for younger players. Sometimes it's a bit misplaced as well, you know, the value that you add, what you get. But it's a fact that comes with this kind of free enterprise cricket that we see. So we've got to be just not try and stop it or, you know, do something so that, you know, they don't get the big bucks or put a salary cap and stuff like that. I think what you need then is mentoring. Hopefully somebody around the kid, telling him the reality of it. But there have been a lot of T20 talents who earned crores for a couple of years and then just faded away, nowhere to be seen again. So I think a lot of these younger players, if you see, they're more mature and they're aware of all these pitfalls that come with the quick recognition and the big bucks.
Is it a bad thing to aspire to only play IPL?
again, you know, I don't know whether it's my age, but I don't find fault with that thinking as well. Right. There are different kind of people, different needs. Somebody who is not ambitious enough, not ready to go through the hard grind of wanting to be a pujara. And what pujara does, I mean, the amount of energy that he spends on the field. I mean, it, for a T20 player, it could be 4 or 5 seasons of IPL. The kind of, you know,
endurance.
Yeah. And yes, so, yes. But he's happy to do it. He enjoys it.
Sure.
Some, I mean, we look at all kinds of people around us, right? Different nature, different.
So nothing
motivation,
wrong with that thought process.
Nothing wrong with that at all.
Very well. A lot of overseas players and a lot of Indian players tend to go for huge money at auctions, depending on the dynamics of that particular auction, and sometimes that just it blows up in their face. You know, Pawan Negi, poor chap, for no fault of his own, went for extraordinary money. And probably carried the weight of that price tag in the whole season.
He visibly did.
We've seen it with Yuvraj Singh, as good a player as he was, to go in successive auctions for huge money. Chris Morris, too, great player, but suddenly we expected him to be Superman because of the money he went for.
Cut whether his performance in the Nidahas Trophy had something to do with the price tag he's got this time. So.
I mean, so give me your take on it. I mean, how does it affect, how do we balance the effect it has on a player? Can it be managed?
I don't think it can be managed because dynamics, as you said, so Jaidev Unnatkat ended up getting the kind of money that he did. Now, what happens in such cases if a Negi didn't handle that well and faded away a little bit, he's still there and hopefully come back? It actually tells you the temperament and the nature of the person, the character of the person. So if he's not been able to handle it too well, then maybe down the line, if there was no IPL, he would have exposed that weakness playing test cricket and international cricket as well. Because when you have a long career at the highest level, all these aspects get tested. Now, Yuvraj Singh, when he got his 14 crores, I think it was, came at the wrong time when his own self-confidence had diminished. So that was, again, Yuvraj Singh's temperament coming to haunt him. So if it's going to affect a player, then it's the temperament of the player. Now, there are a lot of others in the IPL who are able to insulate themselves from all the valuation that goes around them and IPL cricket as well. And those are the kinds of players who would eventually made a mark as well without the IPL and the big bucks because of the kind of nature and temperament. This is a new, actually, I found that temperament is actually a sporting word for nature.
Okay. You know, you said it's good for all of us to be skeptical. I think it's also at times fun for all of us to speculate a little, fantasize, you know, get into hypotheticals. So, you played in an era where there were a number of players that you felt, if they would have been around during T20 cricket, we could have seen something special. So let's just try and have some fun and pick an IPL team, you know, with the same rules of 4 foreign players and 7 Indians. And let's see how far we get before we completely lose track with players that were there before the T20 era. So who comes to mind first? You know, if I say, let's take Indian players. I think Viv Richards is...
I know he's played for a couple of seasons, Sachin Tendulkar. But Sachin Tendulkar, when he was 19 years old, at 19, he went after each and every bowler, every ball. And I think he would have been the best T20 player at the time.
By far.
Yeah, because he had no weakness. Oh, he was incredible. So he would have been one. Viv Richards, definitely.
No,
because even in that time, when people were striking at about 65, 70, 75, he was close to 90 on his own, Viv Richards. So he would have been a tremendous T20 player. So he would have been certainly one of the overseas players.
Sure.
Wasim Akram, for sure, as a bowler, would have been one of the players to, that anybody would have had in their side.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe not so much Waqar Yunus.
Mm-hmm.
Or
Wasim could bat a little better. He could be a handyman at, you know, 7 or 8 coming in. Let's continue thinking because this is a fun, exciting little example.
Let's talk about spinners as to which spinner would have been from the olden times.
I mean, Anil Kumble played a little bit, so let's go further back.
Yeah, I'm thinking about,
you know, guys who could maybe fire it in. Maybe Abdul Qadir, would he have played?
I'm thinking about guys who never played for India. Bishan Singh Bedi was a very sort of, so, you know, Irapalli Prasanna and all those guys. Would
maybe
have
Chandra as a
Chandra would have been
player.
Good, and Rajinder Goyal and Padmakar Shivalkar, two domestic players who were so accurate and weren't, you know, guys who believed in buying wickets. They used to stifle batsmen down, so they would have been great. But I think you go to, for example, Australia, you know, there was a time, Ian Botham, for example, if you remember, there was a time when he was opening the innings for England and went after the bowling the first 10, 15 overs, he would have been brilliant at the top of...
You can't help but think that the job that Manoj Prabhakar did in
He would have been a better bowler than a batsman because he didn't have the power game.
Right.
Yeah. Kapil Dev would have been your reliable seam bowler, you know, and batting down the order. So it would have been a pretty good team.
Yeah. Sandeep
Patil. There's another lesser name that I'd like to take. Yes, Sandeep Patil. A Raman Lamba, you know, played for a little while, not with us anymore. And recently I was talking with some fellow cricketers about how he would have been as a T20 player on our pitches because he was another, you know, unstoppable player. Krishnamacharya Srikanth as well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So not a bad. Where would you put yourself in the list?
See, I used to think before I gave it more thought that I would have been useless at T20 cricket. But then I looked at my own performances in the Hong Kong Sixes, and there was one year I was like a man of the series kind of batsman in that whole tournament.
My.
Where it was just a matter of 5 overs and scoring maximum. And I kept hitting the ball out of the park. So maybe, who knows, I would have found a way to becoming a good T20 player, just like I found a way of becoming a T20 commentator from being a test and 50 overs commentator.
Do you still harbour that ambition? T20 is not really a young man's game.
Yes, it's just about going and belting the ball. Oh, or maybe giving strike to Virat Kohli or something.
Very well. And you were good at that. Yes. Well, this was great fun, Sanjay Manjrekar.
You were listening to the podcast on the Indian Premier League with Sanjay Manjrekar and Raunak Kapoor, exclusively on Storytel, the mobile service application where you can listen to more than 10,000 books. Change the way you read, whenever, wherever.